Good to go.
All right, great. Well, thank you. I'm used to being the sidekick here on the webinars, but this is my presentation that I put together. So Scott asked me to take over and he'll be my sidekick. So he'll keep an eye on the chat box and let me know when there's questions that are good to pause and address. And then we should have plenty of time at the end for questions as well. So I hope everybody has their chat box open. If you don't, then please open that. And what I'd like you to do is just to get warmed up a little bit is type in how many techs your company employs, including yourself. So if you're a one-man shop, you would type in one. And then let's see how many everybody has. All right, wow, numbers are just flying by. That's awesome. So we do have a number of people with one, you know, presumably themselves, and they're probably here because they're looking to grow. And then we have a lot of people with single digits up to double digits. So that's great. All right, good. Well, thank you. All right, let's get going. So many of you might already be familiar with me. I won't take too long to introduce myself, but I am Susan Brown. And along with Scott, the Samurai, we run Master Samurai Tech. I've been helping Scott to run our own appliance repair business that we started in the 90s. So we have a lot of experience with that. And then we started Master Samurai Tech in 2014. I helped to develop the courses there. Scott was responsible for the majority of the content, and I would come in afterwards and shape it and help to make it a little bit more understandable. I had to come behind him and learn it, and then I helped to add to the explanations as needed, things like that. I also just recently created a new course, our newest course, which is for customer service reps. So it's called 5-Star Customer Support. So if you have CSRs that you would like to train to know more about appliances, how they work, just, you know, the level of depth that is good for a CSR to be able to communicate well with the customers and with the techs, we've got that available now. So we've been really honored to work with a lot of companies over the last few years, helping them to train their techs. We've helped companies hire and train their first tech. We work with self-servicing dealers to grow their crew up to a couple dozen or more techs. And we've even worked with some large-scale utility companies who have 100 techs and they need to improve their skills or cross-train them. So we've gotten a lot of feedback over the years from different companies of different sizes. And we've distilled down a lot of that information to pass along to you. All right, let's dive in. So most business owners we meet are desperately looking for ways to increase the size of their team. Quite often, they're not able to schedule jobs as quickly as they want. They're putting customers off, which means they're risking losing them. Maybe they want to increase their territory or have more options for specialization within their team. Any of those reasons are important reasons they'd like to hire more. And in fact, we were hearing this need so often when we were attending conferences like ASTI or interacting with people on Appliantology. That's a really big motivation and reason why we started Master Samurai Tech and created formal training courses. We've been running Appliantology.org, which many of you might be familiar with, for years, since the early 2000s. And Master Samurai Tech was 2014. We created those courses to address this very need that we're talking about tonight. So the two options you have basically to build your team, hire an existing tech or to build a tech with training. Which one is best? Well, you know, you may already know the answer to that based on the focus of this presentation, but let's just quickly run through the pros and cons of those two approaches. So hiring an experienced tech, it's got a few obvious pros. The tech can hit the ground running, can be immediately productive. very little onboarding involved. That's good for your cash flow. You know, you can click them in and they get going right away. The biggest disadvantage is they're very difficult to find, nearly impossible. But beside that, even those you do find, they might have some bad habits that are you really want them to be trained out of, but they might be resistant to change. Their technical abilities may be inadequate. Scott has a way of saying something like, somebody could say they have 20 years of experience, but it might be actually 1 year of experience repeated 20 times. And so you might hire somebody who has a few years of experience only to find out they actually still need some more training. And obviously they're going to expect a higher rate of pay starting right away before you even know really how well they're going to perform. All right, let's compare that with building a tech, pros and cons with that. So big pro, you can train them your way. You know, they're putty in your hands. Assuming you hire a good candidate, you can really shape them. And that can lead to a lot of long-range satisfaction. Candidates who are being given training and skills are usually going to be pretty grateful for that and usually willing to learn and put in the effort. That means they often will have a better attitude towards learning. Now, even though you'll be investing in them and they won't be super productive right away, there's still benefits they can provide by being a second man on jobs and things like that. And obviously when they're in the training phase, you will be giving them, generally speaking, a lower pay than when they become independent. So the downsides to this approach is, you know, the biggest one for most people is having to invest in the training and the amount of time it would take before they're fully productive. Now that length of time can be 6 months to 9 months to a year. And I'm gonna go break this down in a little bit as we go along before they're fully productive. That doesn't mean they won't be partially productive. So it's not, you know, 6 to 9 months where they're bringing in no income. Don't think along those lines. So it is more costly in the short term. And the last thing is it can take a little more work to find the right candidate. That's a little less obvious, but don't worry, we're going to cover that as well. So a lot of people at this point are going, you know, I see all the advantages to building a tech, but gosh, wouldn't it just be easier to find an existing tech and who has some experience and just click them in and get them going? Unfortunately, the reality check for most of us is there are very few good quality techs with experience on the job market. So it is really, we've worked with so many companies over the last few years who have just found that once they bit the bullet and created a training plan and started to implement it, that they were really pleased with the results. And, you know, they can kind of create this machine that just kind of keeps cranking out experienced techs. So that's awesome. And we have really been privileged to work with a lot of clients who have done some great work. They've been innovative. They've come up with written plans and they tweak them as they go along. And they share that knowledge with us. And we've kind of distilled it together into this presentation so we can share it with everyone else. So some of the people on today I have learned from, and I really appreciate that. All right. So, and this last point here is that with smart planning, even a trainee can contribute to profitability because there are lower skill tasks that can be, that are revenue generating, that if you think ahead and train them on quickly, then they will be contributing to your bottom line more quickly. Okay, so let's say you're on board. Yes, we're just gonna have to hire based on character and then add the skills and add the training and build a tech. So we're going to kind of quickly go through the hiring process. You could do a whole big presentation. In fact, people do often do these at ASTI and elsewhere on how to hire. So I'm just going to fairly quickly go through this. One of the big tips, though, is definitely identify that you're going to be providing paid training when you are recruiting, because that is a big draw. And you want to make sure that people know that. So the basic job requirements you're going to be looking for right away before diving into more details is, you know, driver's license, clean driving record, background screening, and just the basic physical ability that the need to do appliance repair, which fortunately isn't, it isn't super difficult. I mean, you all know what's required and you can screen that pretty easily. Some larger companies will actually do a physical as part of this. All right, and so if I've passed those criteria, then the next step is to look at their character, their customer service qualities. One thing that's kind of cool about what appliance techs do is if they have the skills to interact well with customers, then they're likely to have the skills to interact well with you and the rest of your staff. And here's a few thoughts that I put down. Obviously, you want them to have a good work ethic. They need to be friendly. They're going to be going in people's homes, presentable, honest, and able to communicate clearly. Some of these things you can definitely train and improve on, but some of them are just going to be kind of fundamental to that person. And so you'll be looking for these things. And when you find these qualities in a candidate, then you'll need to consider their technical qualities. So obviously you're going to be training them, but you need to look for aptitude. And with appliance repair, that's a mix of both mechanical, but also technical, meaning troubleshooting, problem solving, understanding technology. So it's not, mechanical aptitude is great and is important, but so is the thought process that is behind troubleshooting. So what are the things you can look for? If they're a relatively recent graduate of high school or, you know, relatively young, you could talk to them about their education, ask for a transcript, that kind of thing. If they had decent grades in math and science, then that's going to be a really good tip that they've got what it would take to get through the training and to do well in the trade. This can be a little tricky because plenty of guys who are attracted to a skilled trade were not necessarily confident students. They weren't really comfortable in an academic setting, but that doesn't mean that they're not bright or they don't have the basic ability. So sometimes you have to dig a little deeper if they don't have good grades to show you or something like that. Obviously, if they have any technical training that they received, either in high school or afterwards, you'd want to know about that. You would want to know if they have any job experience in fields that were in some way technical, working with their hands, troubleshooting, anything, you'd want to know about that. You can also try to look into what kind of hobbies. Are they the kind of person that tinkers with machines or cars? Do they enjoy building kits? Anything that would be an evidence that they have problem-solving mentality, that they have a curiosity about how things work. Those are all tips on how to evaluate this, their aptitude. And related to that is the fact that you want to see if they're going to be able to get through the technical training that you're going to be spending money on to put them through. And so one first step to think about there is their reading and writing skills. And basically speaking, from our point of view, with our online training, if they have the ability to communicate with your customers, if you're comfortable with their communication skills in that way, they should do fine with online training. So we've worked with plenty of students where English is their second or third language. And because it's self-paced, they can go a little slower if they need to, they can replay videos, and we're always available, they can ask for help. So we've had no problem with students where English was their second language. Like I said, if they can communicate well enough to that you're gonna send them out to customers' homes, they'll be fine. They do need to be able to do a little basic math. This can be a freak out point for some of our students because, you know, the classic, I didn't do well in math. I don't know math. But they do have to do a little basic math to be able to learn basic electricity. It's just the fact. And I mean, we're just talking about multiplication and division. Interestingly, the ability to do simple math and like super simple algebra type thing where you just have an equation and you know how to plug in a couple of the variables and find the answer. The ability to do that math is a really good proxy for the ability to be a good technician. It just means your brain works in that linear thinking, that troubleshooting pattern. So tuck that away as knowledge for how to evaluate how a tech's going to do, or how a novice that you're looking at hiring might do with both the training, but also the trade. I had mentioned before, a curiosity about how things work is a real plus, because that will help them be more engaged with both their training, but also their continuing education and their job. Lastly, they have to know that with training is not just sitting back watching videos like you would watch television. It takes effort. And sometimes it's a little painful, but learning things is, but it pays off. It pays off so, so big. All right, before we move on to the next step, I just thought, since this is a workshop and many of you have had experience recruiting and hiring, so besides the things I've mentioned, any of you have any great tips on qualities that you look for in a candidate? If you could type it into the chat box, we'll see what you guys have to say. Any other ideas? Showing up early to the interview, calling ahead. Yes, that's one of the big complaints that I hear is just, you know, those basic things about not showing up on time, things like that. So, so wants to be employed versus entrepreneur. And that's tricky. Everybody's a little worried about that. I'm writing likable person. I can't talk and write at the same time. Everybody's a little worried about training their competition. And that's just comes with the territory to some extent, but you can plan for that. Like I say, you can try to discern if somebody is looking for employment, if they're comfortable with that, but you can also build in non-compete clauses, or if you're going to be investing in their training, that they, if they leave the company within a certain amount of time, they will need to pay back the expense. That doesn't completely recoup your loss, but it definitely would help if you're going to invest in their training. So, multiple languages for certain cities, then that would be a real plus. And good driving record, definitely following instructions, application instructions. Yeah, if they can't even do that, how are they going to be able to read a schematic? Military background, you know, this is something we do. I'm seeing a couple of different experiences on the chat box, and that's something we've seen as well. And I just think it's a large pool of people, and like any large pool of people, you're going to have some who are really sharp and good to go, ready to go. Others, not so much. And from what we see from a training point of view, it seems to depend on, it's kind of hard to say, but what shape they're in. Some of them had difficult experience. Yes, they can be very much more disciplined. And some of them have the physical impairments or difficulties that they're still dealing with, PTSD, that type of thing. So those are questions that you definitely want to look into when you're considering vets. Okay, so let's move on real quick to where do you find candidates? I know I remember hearing Paul McDonald in an ASTI describing just basically anytime he ran across somebody who impressed him, he'd hand them a card and say, "Would you like a job?" Nah, I don't think people are quite desperate enough for Home Depot parking lots yet, but you know, there's been such demand for appliance techs. I know some people will look into trade school. I see that there. I don't know how many high schools have good vocational programs, but those that do, that's somebody who, there'd be young people, and young people come with a little bit of their own risk in terms of they don't have much work experience. But again, that's something you can account for. I'm trying to read people's things. Parts Warehouse, thing called Skill Bridge, which is a military transition program, it sounds like. And I know there's a number of those. We've had students who were, their training was paid for by, usually I think it's a more of a private charity that's aimed at vets, helping them to transition. Referrals from current techs, that's a good idea. And that's actually something we see. We see somebody, people who will sign up for our training and say, well, my friend does appliance repair and he's doing really well, so I've decided to get into it. Furniture, kitchen, cabinet installers. And ads, obviously, and there's all the websites that people put up listings on. HVAC, we see a lot of students, usually they're getting, they've been doing HVAC for 10 to 20 years, and they decide they're really tired of being in the hot attics and things like that. And as their bodies are aging a little bit, they're ready to work in the kitchens and laundry rooms instead. So those are good too. Yeah, websites. So Indeed, somebody mentioned. So yeah, okay, great. Good ideas. And I know companies that grow bigger teams of techs, they're just basically always on the lookout and always trying to have people in the recruiting pipeline. Commercial, that's an interesting comment, Paul. Commercial techs are out of work with the pandemic. That's right, particularly in states where restaurants have been more limited, I would assume. So that's a good thought, commercial techs. And yeah, Scott, we have seen this past year, now hopefully if things normalize a bit more in the coming years, this will be less of a factor. But for right now, there are a lot of people whose livelihoods have been shut down, and they're not expecting them to come back too soon. We have had at least two, if not more, pilots, airline pilots, come to get training at Master Samurai Tech because I assume they were pretty low down on the totem pole and they did not expect to be able to get flying again for a number of years. You can also, a lot of people transition over from maintenance jobs. So, whether it's apartment maintenance, hospital techs, things like that. So that's something else to keep in mind. All right, I think we've got some great ideas there. Let's move on. So, okay. So let's say through this process, you've got a good prospect, somebody you want to make an offer to. So again, you want to just throughout this process, set expectations and then eventually have written agreement as to how things are going to go, how they're going to be onboarded and what's going to be expected of them. If they're a new hire, ideally this will be in your employment contract with them. But it can also be, particularly if this is somebody who perhaps already works for you, but they still need training, you can still do a written agreement. You're just basically wanting to lay out expectations. So obviously you'd list the training program or courses that they're expected to complete. You want to include details such as timeframe, what certification requirements you expect of them. At Master Samurai Tech, students can earn certification, and to do so, they have to get high scores. So most employers want that. If they're going to spend the time doing the training, they want them to master as much of the material as possible. You want to set up whatever incentives you have for completion. It could be a bonus. A lot of guys will get an increased pay rate. They won't be a trainee level anymore, or they'll be eligible for commission, things like that. Also, one thing we've discovered is that techs love recognition. Sometimes that seems more important to them than the money. I mean, most people still want the money, but the certificate, the printed certificate, maybe a special patch for their uniform, a little celebration when they've earned certification, they're at the office, social media posts, things like that. Those are always really good at encouraging them to complete the course, get their certification. And, you know, you've got the carrots, but you also have to have the stick there. Any penalties that you have in place if they don't complete or they don't earn their certification, you want that to be clearly laid out too. Some companies will include termination if they don't finish the courses in a particular period of time. They don't always follow through on that. Sometimes you have a guy that is maybe taking a little longer to get through the courses. Maybe he needs a little bit more help to get through them, but his customer service skills are just out of sight. And so you know that it's worth the investment, it's worth giving him time, but you want that in your back pocket, because sometimes during this training process, you're going to see other things that are concerning, and you realize it's better to go ahead and let them go. And this could be a reason for doing that. And also the thing I mentioned before, docking their pay for the cost of the training if they decide to leave before a certain period of time. Some companies do 1 year, some do 2 years, or they might do prorated. That's up to you. And I've been told from people who live in different states that labor laws can sometimes dictate exactly how you can arrange that. So make sure you keep that in mind. All right, here's a pro tip. Before investing in their training, have them do a ride-along with an experienced or senior tech. Some companies will do this before. They'll do a ride-along day before they even complete the hiring contract. And this, again, would be for somebody who's never done appliance repair. You really want to do this. Some companies build it into their onboarding. They'll have the new hire ride-along for a week. One company I know does it up to a month. So what this is doing is, before you invest in the training, then you give them a chance to really see what the job is like day in and day out. Because if they've not had that experience, they may think it sounds great, but then when they see it, maybe they decide that it's not the right job for them. And everybody would rather find that out early on before too much time has passed, and particularly before you've invested in their training. But one thing to keep in mind is they will still be getting some training during this time from that senior tech that they're riding along with. They're going to be watching him interact with customers and starting to learn what that looks like. They can learn how to move the appliances in and out, or if you do installations, they could be learning that, cleaning vents, any of these kind of lower skill tasks they can start to learn right away. All right, so let's say you've got your guy or gal. We are seeing many more gals enter the trade now, which is awesome. So let's say you've got them hired and you're ready to start training them. What type of training do you want to do? And what's great now is that there are a lot of good training options out there, so you don't have to do all the heavy lifting. And here are the basic three modes that you can use for their training. Online schools like we offer at Master Samurai Tech, in-person training, which are, you know, the three-week typical training programs that are residential, and then trade schools. Now, I'm going to go ahead and X out the trade schools only because we only occasionally hear people say that they have a trade school near them that really does a good job preparing techs. It seems like most of them out there are not worth the time and money it takes to send them to a trade school. So you may have a really great one near you that you want to use, and that's great. But I'm going to focus on the other two options that are the most commonly ones used today. And I did see there was a question about training expectations to complete, and I am going to break that down for you in just a couple of minutes. So hang in there. All right. So in-person specialty training, you know, your Fred's, your Dyer's, those types of places. The advantages to that is you have an in-person instructor. You have a built-in hands-on component. Those aspects can make it less intimidating for some students. And they probably, a lot of them like that camaraderie that you get in a group setting. So those are all good advantages for that type of program. The main disadvantage is the cost. It is much more expensive. You're having to pay for an in-person instructor, the facilities, the housing, meals, travel, and whatever pay that they're getting during that stretch of time. Those group dynamics that can be a plus can sometimes be a negative, and it's a little bit of a roll of the dice what group you're going to get on in a particular session. Your tech may need things to go a little slower, maybe a little faster than the group is going at. Sometimes there'll be one or two people in the group that are kind of monopolizing the questions or the conversations. So that's something that's a little bit out of your control when you go this route. What we've seen from the feedback we get is that these in-person trainings don't really prepare techs well enough in the area of schematics, reading, and troubleshooting. So they still need more training when they get back. And basically, if you hire somebody with no experience, they're not going to go to a 3-week training and come back and be ready to just hit the ground running in a van. There's still going to be some more training when they get back. So let's compare that to online training, such as we offer at Master Samurai Tech. So big advantages there are they're self-paced. So tech can get on whenever he wants or needs to or is asked to, work as long as he wants to, and at his own pace. You can repeat things if there's sections that are pretty familiar and easy for that particular person that can go quickly. So that's a big advantage. One of the biggest advantages is how cost-effective it is. You get a lot of the interactivity that you want out of training, but because all the lessons are pre-recorded, you're not paying for the instructor to teach live each time. So that saves a lot of money. There's no travel, there's no facilities. And so that makes it a really good option. And then one of the things that I love about online training is the software gives us the opportunity to have lots of quizzes and exams along the way. So this helps a student know right away, because they're automatically graded. They can know right away if they mastered the material well enough to move on, or if they miss some questions, they can go back and figure out why they missed them, get the answers. So that's a really important feature that you don't get in other programs generally. The disadvantages is there's not a live instructor right in front of the student. But again, we at Master Samurai Tech, we do offer personal interactive help in the form of forums. So that goes part way towards meeting that or taking care of that disadvantage. Some students or, you know, techs in training have an insecurity about an academic setting. They get a little freaked out about test taking. That again can be handled with some coaching, but it is something to be aware of. And of course, online training is all visual rather than hands-on. But again, we're going to break down how you can provide the hands-on training yourself. I mean, we've had so many students who come and they take our courses, and these are guys maybe who are just going to start doing their own thing. They just start working on their own appliances. They work on their friends and neighbors and relatives. And, you know, it doesn't take that long before somebody can take our training and be out there being effective with it. All right. So you're probably not surprised to hear me say that we recommend online training for all the reasons that we listed. And I'm just going to take a quick moment and say, in the world of online training, why we think you should choose Master Samurai Tech. We are we have a reputation for extremely high quality training. And a lot of that comes out of the fact that we have kind of a unique combination of experience. It's just the way our lives have gone. We've spent over 20 years running an appliance repair business, and we've spent about that much time working with techs online at Appliantology and then eventually Master Samurai Tech. So we really got a close insight, deep insight into thousands of techs out there, where their knowledge gaps were, and what, you know, what kind of training they really needed. And so that's what we, when we set out in 2014 with our first old fundamentals course that has been upgraded since then to the core course, we wanted to fill in these gaps. So we have one thing you can do. I'll click over and show you. It's extremely gratified with the reviews we get. This is just from one of our courses. We get really good reviews. And I think because where our goal has always been to over deliver on quality. So our courses are comprehensive. We have our core appliance repair course that gives all the really foundational things they need to know. But then we have advanced courses that cover all the types of appliances, diving deeper into each one. So if they take all of our courses, they're going to really get comprehensive coverage. And then we offer a lot of accountability with a very unique quiz and exam structure, including a couple of open exams. I had mentioned automatically graded quizzes, but we also have in our core course, these really powerful open answer exams where they have to write in the answers and we grade them, we give them feedback. So I am seeing a few questions in the chat box that I am just about to get to. All right, let's move on. So implementing the online training model. This is the basic layout of the training periods. Now, I just want to point out that this is based on lots of experiences out there that we've been privy to and typical, meaning average timing. So some trainees are going to go faster, some are going to be slower, but this gives you a starting point and a rough idea of what to expect. So the trainee period, roughly 3 months, that is when they are really just doing their online courses and ride-alongs, no independent work yet. Transition period would be the next stage where they're starting to blend their studies and their ride-alongs with some independent calls. And then what I call the rookie phase, which is another 3 months or so where they are running calls 5 days a week, but they're still coming up to speed. So we're going to break these down. All right, let's take a little closer look at this trainee period, those first 3 months. And I'm seeing a lot of your chat questions and many of the things you're asking, I will be addressing. Somebody just asked if we'd have access to the slide deck afterwards. We're going to have actually an even bigger document that's going to go over this and be fleshed out even more that's going to be available soon. And I'll show you where you'll be able to find that. All right, so the trainee period, that is where they're taking courses, the online courses, and mixing that in with hands-on training. So one of the questions people have is where should they take their online courses? Should they do it at home? Should they do it in the office? And, you know, how long? Do we just have them do it 8 hours a day till they've finished them or what? So all of that is up to you. It's very flexible, but this is what we have found works best for most people. So first of all, it's usually best if you have an office, assuming there's a quiet spot where they could do the courses, that's better than asking them to do it at home. It depends what their home life is like. Sometimes they've got kids running around. Sometimes they just don't have the discipline to do it at home. They've got too many distractions. So if it's at all possible, we recommend they do it in the office. Also with having somebody supervising them is going to help with accountability. Preferably, you only want them to study online, maybe a couple of hours at a time, once or twice a day. You can get burned out pretty quickly just sitting at a computer studying. I think especially people who are drawn to a skilled trade would have that problem. That being said, we do have occasional situations. There's a couple of utility companies that use our training and their union shops, and they just have something where if they're going to be doing training, they have to be pulled off the road and sit and do training all day long. So that's just their setup. And they make it work. They give them breaks and make sure that they're not getting burned out. So I thought I'd take a quick moment and hop over to just to show you, because at this point you may be wondering, those of you who aren't familiar with our courses or haven't used them, what a typical lesson looks like. And I just picked this as out of our, this is in our core appliance repair training course. That's the one that essentially every tech out there should take, even if they have experience. And so you can see over here, the layout of the course. There's modules, and within each module are units, and they're basically lessons. So we've given them their orientation. They go through a module on tools, basic electricity, basic electronics, really and critical things to lay the foundation for then troubleshooting. So this is one of the lessons in troubleshooting. So there's always a little text. Most lessons have one or more videos. In this case, we happen to have two videos that they'd watch. And then here's one of the quizzes. So you can see this particular one, because we've already gotten into reading schematics, we are able to give them some snippets of schematics and ask various questions. And so that is what a typical lesson looks like. They get their, on these, they get their feedback right away once they've submitted all their answers. And I will just point out that we do build in two attempts on each quiz. We are wanting them to aim for mastery. This isn't just like a school where you're trying to get some score and compare them to other students in some way. This is all about them learning. So we work really hard to challenge them, but not to stress them out, because stress doesn't do anybody any good. We want them to just work hard to figure out the answers. And if they don't get the score they need after those built-in two attempts, they can work with us to get help and then get it reset so they can retake it. So it's all about working with them to help them learn. And we do have forums, these Ask the Teacher forums. That is where they can ask us for personalized help, and we'll interact with them and give them what they need. All right, let's go back here. So that was just a quick little glimpse at what the training looks like and how it works. So this concept of mixing hands-on training, and by hands-on training, I mean riding along with a senior tech. That is the most common thing. But if you happen to have a shop, that's really nice, because they can work on appliances in a much lower stress environment without a customer there staring at them, and start to get up to speed. So mixing the two, doing online training and hands-on training and practice, back and forth, it's a great feedback loop. It basically gives their online training context, and in the field, they'll start to apply what they've learned, and that will reveal, you know, that'll help some things click, but it'll also reveal other questions they end up having that they can either get answered by their supervisor or by us. So that's a really fantastic way to blend it. The one other important aspect to this phase, this trainee phase, is the supervision. While they're doing the online training, you need to have regular check-ins to make sure they are progressing. You should have set up expectations for how much time you expect them to spend and where you expect them to get to on a periodic basis. And then you need to check in at least weekly, depending on what expectations you've set, to make sure they are progressing as they say. And I'm going to show you real quick. So if you have two or more techs training with us, we can set up what's called a supervisor dashboard. So here I am at Master Samurai Tech, and I'm logged into my own account. And I set myself up as a supervisor of a tech that we call Super Tech. And so this would be just your login page, basically. When you log into your account at the site, you would land on this page, and any techs that you have, would they would each have a block like this. And so then you can look, you click a course that they're working in, and it reveals all of the lessons. And it's got the green check mark when they've finished it, and it shows you their quiz grade. So you could look at this and look at this 18.2%, and that would cause you probably to want to have a conversation. So this is a handy way to keep track of their progress. We also have other resources I wanted to point out up here. Any page at the site, you're going to see this for employers up in the upper left. Or if you're on mobile, it'll be in the. I think it's also up there, now that I think about it. So there's some really good links here for employers, how online training works. That has some videos that shows how the courses work, kind of unpacks a little more detail what I was just showing you a few minutes ago. This section, supervising your techs, we have some downloadable documents that you can use, and we have some other suggestions for supervising them while they're training, while they're doing their online training. So check that out when you get a chance. We mentioned here this overseeing academic integrity. That's especially important when you have a multi-tech shop and if you have multiple techs going through the courses. We fortunately don't get it too often, but occasionally we do see that, or it's obvious that they're helping each other with quizzes, and that is a big no-no. So not only does it go against our terms, what we expect of a student, it means they're not necessarily learning what you want them to learn. This is their training. It's not just some bureaucratic box that they need to check off and get through. This is going to determine how effective they're going to be in the field. All right. I see somebody asking, great question. How many hours does each course take? So when you're at the site, I have to, let's see, I'm going to go to the main home. This is if you just go to mastersamuraitech.com, and click resources. And we have these great mega menus. So just click around, you'll find all kinds of great stuff. But anyway, FAQs. If you go to our FAQ page, just scroll down a little bit. Here it is. We have a section that gives approximate time range for each course. So depending on what you sign your tech up for, that's a great question, because as you're laying out their training plan, this will help you figure out how much time to allot per course. All right. And if you ever forget any of the stuff I'm showing you, we are going to, like I said, we're going to have a downloadable document that's going to have all this stuff, but just click contact us and shoot us an email. We're happy to help. All right, one last comment about ride-alongs and shop work is to focus on training the new guy or gal to do easy revenue-generating tasks with an eye towards the transition phase that we're just going to talk about now. So after their initial 3 months, plus or minus, some guys are faster than others, then you're ready to start transitioning them to running some independent calls. Now, I have to say, some shops are small and they really have to speed this process up. They've just got to get that second guy on the road. Larger companies tend to be able to pace this out, and they know it's worth it to take the time building the tech early on so that they're really effective later. But, you know, like any plan, you have a good, solid written plan, but you're going to have to make adjustments as you go along, depending on your circumstances. So this transition phase means that 2 to 3 days a week, ideally, they're doing independent calls. Now you're going to not schedule them full out, probably 3 to 4 calls a day max to start with, and work up from there to give them, so they don't feel rushed. They need to feel you know, they'll get plenty of stress as time goes on, but you're trying to, you know, they're just going to have some stress from being new and having to deal with the customers and those types of things. So you try not to overload them. And as best you can, hand select jobs that you think they are well suited for. They'll need to be supervised during this period to help them both prepare for a job, follow up with any issues or callbacks. You may even have a situation where they're able to call the supervisor if they're at the job. You want to discourage that. You don't want it to be a crutch, but you also don't want to lose a customer because you didn't take advantage of, you know, talking to them on the phone and giving them some help. During this time, you can be working to get customer feedback, more than usual anyway, on how they did to help improve their performance. And then the days they are not doing these independent calls, they would be finishing up their coursework and continuing to do ride-alongs or shop work. So we recommend you set up a regular meeting during this phase. You'll have some day-to-day things, but then like a once a week chat to really look back over, identify any strengths or weaknesses that need to be discussed. And then the final step is what I call rookie. So at this point, they finished their courses, their skills are improving, they're ready, or maybe they're already, you know, just started doing 5 days a week running calls. And so this is the time period where you just keep ramping them up. You can increase the number of calls per day and the difficulty of the calls to transition them to a fully functioning tech. Supervision is still extra important during this phase. They still may need a little assistance with either preparing for their jobs or following up. And you still want to maintain those regular check-ins to offer any corrections that they need, but also encouragement, deal with any issues that might be revealed. This is also a great step to begin their continuing education. One of the things that they will get from being enrolled in any course at Master Samurai Tech is a free student membership at Appliantology. I hope a lot of you are familiar with Appliantology. Those are where our tech forums are, webinar recordings. It's the day-to-day tech support site for professional appliance techs. And they help each other out there. And the webinar recordings alone, I mean, at this point, we've got, well, Scott can type in the box how many hours we have. I forget how many hours we have. But those are great because some of them are kind of fundamental topics, but a lot of them are deeper dives into technology. So it's a great place for techs to continue their education after they have finished their courses at Master Samurai Tech. But while they're a rookie, you can encourage them to go back and review their coursework as well. Anytime you go through a course, you're only going to retain so much. Hopefully they will have taken a lot of good notes. We encourage that a lot because that's a big part of if you're going to retain information and then have something to refer to later is to have really good thorough notes. But they can go back and review any of the coursework that they want to, as long as while they have access to the course. And then you may be offering in-house or manufacturer training. So again, you want to set this good habit and expectation of continuing education. They may think that, oh, it's all over. I finished the Master Samurai Tech courses. Awesome. I don't have to do that anymore. Well, they still have to do something. We all do. I mean, here on Team Samurai, we are still learning. It never stops. So just to summarize what we just went over in terms of timing, again, a initial trainee period, about 3 months. Transition period can be anywhere from 3 to 6 months. So they're generating revenue at that point, but still not a full amount. And then a rookie period where they're working full time, but they're still ramping up to get up to speed and they still need a little extra supervision. So you can see that this kind of, we could call it a novice period, can be roughly 9 to 12 months. But as they say, the YMMV, your mileage may vary. So you can, depending on what your particular needs are, what your business looks like, you can change this around. The important point is to start with a plan, you know, come up with a written plan and then make changes to it as you go along and as you experience using this system. All right. One last point is that a lot of you who already have techs, you may have some guys that have a lot of strengths, but they have weak areas. Maybe their first call complete rates aren't what you'd like them to be. Maybe there's too many callbacks. Maybe there's certain types of jobs that just stump them. When they get outside their comfort zone of sort of, we call it pattern recognition. You know, if this problem, then replace that part. That can help, you know, that's a great level of experience for a tech to have when they're, you know, encountering familiar issues. But if they get stumped when something out of the ordinary is encountered, then you may want them to have more training. And we have a lot, I mentioned earlier, we have a lot of guys who take our core appliance repair training course, even after many years of working, because it just fills in those knowledge gaps. It gives them confidence. It helps them to enjoy their job more. Nobody likes that stressed out feeling. You know, you're standing there with the customer staring at you and you're not sure what to do. So that course helps guys get up to speed. A lot of people call it a game changer, which is awesome. You know, in terms of techs who are already working, it just, it's a lifesaver. So many of the things we've talked about can be implemented with an existing tech where they'd be working on the training a few hours a week and then running their calls otherwise. I mean, you wouldn't need to be offering the hands-on training, obviously. They've already gotten that. They need the online training. The one little tricky part for some guys, if they're already on commission, they don't necessarily want to give up any of their income to spend time training. So you have to work with them on that and figure out what's going to work best. Are they willing to actually put in time at home on their own to do the training and then maybe get a bonus, you know, for completing it at home? Or are you willing to pay them a little, you know, an hourly rate during their training time if they did it at the office? Again, that's got to be negotiated between the two of you. So the bottom line is you still would want some kind of written agreement. They'd need to be supervised. They may not realize that it's going to take a little more effort than maybe they thought to get through the training. So you want to make sure they don't get discouraged and that they're still pushing forward, pushing through it. But it's just such a win-win though to get them happier with their job, you know, usually earning more, and you're benefiting because all of their metrics are going to improve. Somebody asked, how long do you have access to the training? That's a good question. So in fact, I'm going to switch over here and just talk about, let's see, actually here's what I wanted to go first. It's going to give you just a real quick overview. Oh, here we are, 6 o'clock. I wanted to be about an hour and I'm almost done. So thanks for hanging with me, and I'll be wrapping up shortly and then addressing any questions. So at our site, you can click the courses menu, click into any of our courses. I clicked the CL courses just to show you. Here's our core appliance repair training. And then we have our advanced courses where we dive deeper into specific types of appliances, as well as advanced troubleshooting, which gives a lot more practice reading schematics and troubleshooting. We have a soft skills course. Let me scroll down here. We bundle all the courses together, which is the most cost-effective way. And so for technicians, this technicians bundle includes all 5 of our technical courses, plus this delivering professional service, which is a customer service course. But you can just enroll them one at a time. You can start with core. That's what some people like to do, particularly if it's a new hire. You might say, you know, or if you're new to using our training, you might just start with a core course, have them go through that. And when they successfully complete that, you can always sign them up then for the advanced courses bundle, and that adds the other courses on. Most companies, once they get comfortable with our training and confident with their hiring process, they like to do the technicians bundle just get the biggest cost savings. They're all set up with everything you want them to take. So the way the course access works, in fact, what I will do is go over, let me just point out, you can go to any of our courses. If you go to the course details and try a free course sample. So I showed you what one of the lessons looks like, but that gives you a little bit more insight. You can try a free sample of any of our courses. Then we make the enroll button very prominent all over the site, easy to get to this page. If you look here underneath the, this is where just to enroll, let me point this out. If you're just enrolling a guy one at a time, a tech one at a time, you would just come to our enroll page and just start here. You pick your course and then it autofills. See, I'm logged into my account, so it fills this in. If you're signing up somebody new who's never been at our site, then you would make sure you're not logged into anybody's account and you would fill this in. And then make the payment and they're good to go. It starts automatically. And then here's how much what the access is. If you sign up for an individual course, you get a year. You do a bundle, it's 2 years. After that, a subscription automatically begins that will maintain access. So if somebody hasn't finished the courses or they haven't finished reviewing them and they want to maintain access for either $5 or $10 a month, depending on if you have an individual course or a bundle, that will maintain your access. This subscription can be canceled at any time, including before the end of the initial term. Some business owners really just want the 1 year or the 2 years of access and then want it to close down. So that's, you can do that on your end or you can ask us to do that on our end, either way. So that answers that question about how much time you have to access. My last thing I wanted to mention, and then we'll see if there's any questions we wanted to address. There is a multi-tech discount. If you are new to using us, the way that works is you sign one tech up at normal price, then we would create a discount code for your company that gives you 10% off any subsequent enrollments. Once you have enrolled 4 techs, we will bump that up to 15% for your 5th tech onward. If you have a lot of techs you want to enroll, then get in touch with us, use that contact form, because we can go ahead and sign them up as a block. We would just send you one invoice that you pay, we get them signed up. So you wouldn't have to go through the process one at a time on the enroll page. So we like to make it easy for you to get your tech signed up and going. All right, let me see what we have here in the chat box. Is there a course for owners wanting to grow their company? Well, that is a lot of what we're trying to give you tonight. We have a course that is designed for brand new business owners that comes with our business bundle. And it's for the person who's pretty new, who's never started a business or is just starting out. Just a lot of great advice on all the different things that you need to handle, that you need to look into to get started. It is not a course that's, let's say you have 5 techs and you want to learn how to manage all that. It doesn't have that, but that is where Appliantology is a great benefit. We have a lot of business owners over at Appliantology, and in the forums, they frequently have conversations about their businesses and growing them. And that's great because different regions have different particulars in terms of what works and what doesn't work. Sometimes when it comes to either marketing or different business techniques. So I encourage people to be active over at Appliantology in the forums because there's a lot of business owner to business owner conversations there that are helpful. And also the other thing that tech forums are so good for is just helping each other with technical head scratchers. It's a fun job in that there's so much variety that you encounter that it doesn't get boring, but that also means there are head scratchers that come along. And so that's a really important function of the forums over at Appliantology. Any other questions? So the cost for Appliantology, all students get a free 6-month membership at Appliantology, so they can use it while they're students, they can get to know it. And then if they get certified in the core appliance repair training course, then they will qualify for what we call the alumni membership at Appliantology. It's a full premium membership for a full year at no charge, and they can renew it at no charge, assuming they are moderately active at the site. And so that's a really good value that they get along with their enrollment. They will also, students get a lifetime discount. Let's say they don't qualify for or don't maintain their alumni membership. They can just do the regular paid membership for a discount. And then anyone else is welcome to join Appliantology. It is, there's just a regular professional appliantologist membership. I will go over to Appliantology, mouse over memberships. You can read about the tech membership options, what a professional appliantologist membership entails. All right, I'm looking at, so somebody asked, how long do you have access to the trainings? I think if you mean the courses, this is where, if you go to the enroll page at Master Samurai Tech, you can read about the length of access you have to the course and the ongoing subscription if you want to maintain access. Somebody says, no college degree, I make 6 figures being self-employed. Ooh, honestly, thanks to Appliantology. We just never, ever get tired of hearing how we've been helpful to people. Whether it's the training, I remember early on after we started Master Samurai Tech, we ran into an owner who had put his tech through our courses. And he said, you were an answer to prayers. We were just about to have to fire this guy. He was really nice, but just wasn't getting it. And so we thought, well, let's just try one more thing. There's this new samurai courses. And it turned the guy around. He actually ended up becoming the tech that other techs would ask for advice on. So, you know, that was one of our early stories. And we hear it a lot. And we're so glad. And then Appliantology, yeah, we get a lot of people saying that it's their resource, their day-to-day resource. Let's see, some people asking about ASTI Lite. Scott and I are not able to go. We actually have a family wedding that exact same time that we, the wedding will be fun, but we're sorry that we can't go to ASTI Lite. Let's see. Yeah, Sam might, our son Sam might be able to go. We're pretty sure. Kevin, I think Scott is a really good teacher as well. He enjoys teaching. He loves getting the material together. Whenever he's worked on a course in the past, the dining room table would be just covered with books, and just he enjoys taking those deep dives in and then figuring out how to communicate. You know, what do techs really need to know? Some people think do we really need to know Ohm's Law? That just sounds super academic. We are teaching what we know will make somebody a good tech with depth. You know, I mean, think about when you go to see a doctor. Many of the visits a doctor has every day, a patient he sees are easy. You know, they've got an ear infection, they've got indigestion, you know, stuff that they didn't need all those years of medical school for. But for the people who come in with something strange going on, you're glad they have depth to draw on to diagnose. So that's the way appliance tech should be. You should know more than what you're going to need for a lot of jobs so that you have that to draw on for any of those trickier jobs. And so we work hard to figure out, you know, what to present and what to teach that will be effective. You want techs to know to speak with confidence in front of the customer, so that they will have confidence in the tech. And that's a lot of what good training will give to techs.
Susan, I would just add here on Ohm's Law and all that kind of stuff. If you go to my YouTube channel, Samurai Repairman on YouTube, you will see video after video showing me actually applying this stuff in real world service calls that I've done. I'm actually taking the schematic, I'm planning my troubleshooting strategy, and then I pan the camera over to the icky, dirty, ugly wiring in the appliance. I'm picking out my test points that I've selected from the schematic. And I'm doing all of this by my understanding of circuits. And you're not going to understand circuits if you don't understand Ohm's Law. You just, like, you can't see electricity. You can touch it, but you wouldn't like it. So you can't get an intuitive mechanical feel for it. The only way you can understand electricity and circuits is through Ohm's Law. And it's simple little ratio relationships between voltage, current, watts, and resistance. So you've got to understand how these things relate to each other, and it also helps you select your measurement, which one is going to be meaningful to you. And then you want to compare with specs. I've got video after video showing this at my YouTube channel, and also webinar after webinar over to Plantology that demonstrates this as well. It's all about being strategic, selecting what you're going to be measuring and testing, creating a whole troubleshooting plan, and then executing it and doing it quickly. And it's being clever about where you're going to be doing your testing. A lot of times I see guys at a Plantology, and the first thing they think they need to do is tear the whole machine down so they can do an ohms check on a heating element. Well, you don't check AC loads with ohms in the first place. If you're clever and you can pick electrically equivalent points, you can do minimal disassembly to do most of your troubleshooting from a control board or a timer or whatever. And you only do complete teardown to actually do the repair. And I've got multiple videos at the 10-step tango. I've got multiple videos at my YouTube channel and lots of webinars at Appliantology that show this in action. So it's a matter of being clever with your time, and that's all by being strategic and using that stuff between our ears. So we're working smarter, not harder. That means, especially if you're getting paid on commission or if you're paying a tech on commission, that he's going to be making a lot more money because he's going to be able to get in there. He or she is going to be able to get in there, figure out what the problem is, either get the part on order or do the repair right then and there, and then move on to the next job. The more jobs they get done, the more money they make, and the happier the customer is.
All right. Thank you. Yes. Good points. I was looking at the chat box while you were talking. So Shelley, is that how you pronounce your name? The extended access, it's this ongoing course access subscription that begins automatically at the end of the initial enrollment period in any of the courses. But that's also can be canceled if it's no longer needed. And so on the enroll page is where you can read about that. You just scroll down a little bit. And is Appliantology different from the tech training courses? Yes, they are on two different sites. So mastersamuraitech.com is the training site. I'm gonna go to the main home. This is the homepage at mastersamuraitech.com. So you can just go there and begin exploring all the courses and information we have there. I'd shown earlier this for employer section. This is especially good if you're considering training your techs. And then Appliantology is this, appliantology.org. And this is the day-to-day tech support, forums, webinar recordings. So for continuing education, it's great. It's also got a downloads section for manuals and such. So basically you start with the training courses, and then you shift your focus to using Appliantology as you continue on. All right. So we are done with the presentation. I really appreciate all of you coming out. And I mean, we can hang on a few more minutes if anybody has any other questions, but I know some people need to get on to dinner or other activities. Really appreciate you coming out. And if you have any questions, be sure to contact us. And in that, in fact, I forgot to mention it, in this for employer section, keep an eye out on that, because that is where we will be putting this recording and the downloadable PDF we're going to have that unpacks this information for you. So, and we'll be newslettering it. So if you're not on our, that's another thing to point out, if you're not on our mailing list, you can click resources from our main page and newsletter sign up. We also have it if you just, if you scroll down, you can, oh, in the footer, we have a lot of helpful links. Subscribe to newsletter.
All right. Thanks, Susan. And thank you all for coming out. Great to spend time with you this Sunday evening. And,